Hello. I think you guys are here. I'm not quite sure if you guys are seeing this, but we're out here. Oh my goodness. Is this even working? Oh, here we go. Hi. What's up, everyone?
Hello.
Oh my goodness. This is my first time doing this. I'm not quite sure what's happening.
We're out here.
Yes, we're doing it. Oh my goodness. I need to put my tracking of my own voice on mute. What's going on? Hi, Jennifer. I don't know who's going to be here, but this is what we're doing. I just wanted to show off my my dumpling making wisdom that I learned from my mom. What's up, Jenny Kim, Jennifer Kuo? Oh my goodness. I wish I could show you how mad this setup is that I'm doing right now. So first of all, I want you to see what this setup is gonna be. This is me, okay? By the way, do you see that light back there? I set that light up just for you. Yeah, this was stage lighting that I was gonna use for my Everything's Fine show. But that's what I'm doing now. I'm lighting up my own kitchen. And then, because I'm the only person doing this, there's like no one else helping me, I'm going to also switch my own cameras. So if you look at this, you get to see, this will be our camera for seeing the food. Huh? Slippers? Food. I might have to adjust this, but you get it. You get to see what's going on, right? Yeah, that's good. Oh my God. Right? Yeah. It's like a club. So I'm going to start turning on the music, but it's going to be more like upbeat maybe. This is too much. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you for thinking it's sick. I also can do a picture-in-picture. Check this out. What? You see my face. You see my food. See, listen. I literally spent so much time figuring this out. Oh, but thank you for tuning in. I think it's only Jennifer and Jenny. Just I only want audience members who are variations on my name. Really. So hopefully my Wi-Fi streaming is okay and you can hear me. Yeah. Let's hope that. Look at the lighting is cued to the music. What? Okay. So what are we doing today? Today we're making potstickers. Can you hear me okay? Actually, yeah. I have the music on kind of loud. Can you let me know if, you know, the music is working? just because your name isn't Jenny doesn't mean you have to leave. Literally for the first few minutes, it was only Jenny's and Jennifer's, which is, you know, I'm not mad at that. So yeah, can you tell me if I'm loud enough for you all to hear me over the music? I hope so. I'm using the audio from the FaceTime. You gotta watch the color. Okay, cool. Thank you. Thank you for letting me know. Okay, yeah, there's a slight lag. So if I don't see your comments or comment on your comment until later, then, you know. So yeah, thank you, Fiddler 1976 and El Muba. We're doing it. This is my first time doing my own YouTube live stream. I'm my own director and producer and production coordinator, makeup artist. All right, okay. Whew. So we're doing it. We are doing our Taiwanese style potstickers. And, you know, when people ask, like, what is the difference between maybe, like, a typical pot sticker you see or specifically a Taiwanese-style pot sticker, there is a little bit of a difference. I think it really depends on, like, what region. But I think for me, my understanding and sort of my family, we prefer pot stickers that have a slightly thinner skin. You know what I mean? Especially if you're going to pan fry it. If you're going to be like boiling dumplings, then you sometimes need a thicker skin just to make sure nothing like bleeds out in the water. But for the most part, I would say Taiwanese folks like a smaller, thinner dumpling skinned dumpling. If you're Taiwanese, chime in. You know what I mean? Like, please. But yeah. Otherwise, sometimes it's like a little more crescent shape. Or it's like a little longer. I don't know if you've seen that kind. It's a little bit of a more surface area for like the crust, which is the best part of, to me, of a pot sticker. And by the way, we call it a pot sticker, just so you know, because a pot sticker is the literal translation of how you say it in Mandarin, which is guo tie, right? Guo literally means pot, and tie means stick. So I think it's actually pretty cool that we call it pot stickers and that people know that it's called a pot sticker, because there's so many like Mandarin and Chinese words that don't even truly get translated. Like they just become like Chinese tamale. You know what I'm talking about, right? Like 粽子. 粽子 is not Chinese tamale. Chinese tamale, oh, I need to turn off my text messages. Let me stop with the text messages. How do I do that, y'all? How do I stop my friends from texting me? You know what I'm spraying? Do I change the notifications? Is that what happens? Listen, you'd think I'd have this all figured out. But I don't. So hopefully friends don't text me. Oh, you know what I'll do? Yeah. Do you know how that works? Oh, here we go. Let's go to my preferences for messages. And then let's, don't play a sound effect. How about that? Don't play a sound effect. Great. Okay. And we're back. So anyway, like I was saying, what I love about the word pot sticker is that like you get it actually translated directly from Chinese, which you don't get all the time. And like 粽子 is like Chinese, they call it Chinese tamales, which is, tamales are like a Mexican Latinx thing. It's like, why would you call it a Chinese tamale? I get it. That's your point of reference. But a 粽子 is actually its own kind of like rice-based dumpling that usually has a flavoring of the rice or some kind of thing stuffed in the middle, wrapped in some kind of like leaf. So anyway, we're just learning here. I hope you're learning something. Barbara Gilbert has a question. How not to end up with thick pancake depth skins waiting for you to reveal all. Yes, Barbara, I'm here to tell you how to do it. And it takes a little practice to make a thin dumpling skin, and I will teach you. So we're going to get started. Truly, I am going to eyeball things. But for the most part, just to remind me of how we make the stuff, I would say I know how to eyeball the dough because I grew up making it. But there are a couple of really good recipes online that I think are awesome. And so I'm going to share that afterwards. But for the most part, I'm going to teach you how to like do it home style, which is like by feel and by touch and by sight. So we're going to start there. How about that? So for the wrappers, what are we going to do? Wrapper time. Let's wrap. Okay, don't ever watch me rap. Okay, so I am going to show you what's going on here. Okay, we're switching. Look, watch me switch. I'm doing this by myself. Yeah, you see that? This is our workstation, and it's lit and everything. It's literally lit. Okay. So we're going to start off with, I don't know how much I'm going to make. I'm just going to eyeball it. You can see, right? Oh, goodness. We're going to start there. We're not trying to go too ridiculous. Yeah? A little more. Yeah. Okay. So, I don't know. This probably is like three cups. Who knows? Okay. Thank you for the compliments on the switch. Oh, also, if you're interested, feel free to share the link while you're watching so more people come and learn about dumplings and stuff. I don't know, tag people. Say hi to each other. Please say hi to each other. And also, if you want to share, if you have ever with each other, if you want to share if you've ever made dumplings yourself, if you enjoy dumplings, where your favorite dumplings are, tell me your dumpling history. Share it in the comments. I'm going to be able to read them. And you all can talk to each other because obviously Jennifer Quo is already, you know, encouraging and being a friendly friend to like Fiddler over here to tell Fiddler to stay. You know what I'm saying? You guys can do that. Okay. So this is all-purpose flour. This is from, you know, Trader Joe's or whatever. And if I run out, I actually have another pack from the Korean market. So it's all just all-purpose flour, you know, nothing too wild. Probably 3 cups right now. I don't know what I'm doing in terms of measuring. This is not, Asians, we don't measure. You know what I'm saying? Okay, so I'm gonna get water while you enjoy the light show in the back. Okay. Can you hear me back here? Yep. I'm just getting some fresh water. Very excited for you all to get to know each other. Okay. So here's the thing. Usually it is recommended that the water is warm or hot. So I guess I'll do that. Oh, this is still pretty hot. I made coffee, so I'm just gonna drink this water. Oh God. Okay. Is this warm enough? Oh, it's kind of warm. Yeah, I mean, sometimes they say to put hot water. I've done it in all different temperatures. It's fine. So you're gonna see here, I'm just gonna get in here. It's a very delicate process. Anyone who's made dough before knows like the difference between perfectly wet and perfectly dry, whatever you wanna call it, is for sure a process. Oh, that's the other thing I forgot. Here's a trick. I haven't done this in a while, so I'll remember. In order to not get your hands to be so dirty so soon, go get a pair of chopsticks to do this. Okay, I'm gonna do that. Okay. Let's get chopsticks. I'm teaching you all the like, literally the like childhood Mama Yang style, how to do things. So, use chopsticks to kind of mix things in. If you want to do it with some, you know, a little more than lukewarm water, feel free to. And right now we're just checking for, you know, consistency. Because basically what I really love about making fresh potstickers, this is sort of a way for you to all kind of like, I don't know, encourage you to do scratch-made cooking, essentially. Because this is actually not even that hard. I'm not even, like, do you see this? There's like, no salt, no nothing. It's just water and flour. And honestly, you can add salt, but it's that's not the purpose. And, you know, a lot of, I feel like what people don't understand is like a lot of, I don't know, a lot of like Chinese diaspora cooking, I feel like really is about like if the starch is just a very neutral flavor, you can really amp the flavor up in the filling or whatever else that you have with your starch. And so, yeah, I really like a pasta dough like this for dumplings, you know, without the salt. Now, as you can see, it's very soft. What I really love about making scratch-made dumpling skins is that it's actually really great that everything is much softer than you would get it if you were to buy it in a pack in the supermarket. So if you see, this is kind of wet. How many dumplings can I make from this? kind of feel like I need to make more dough. Okay. We're going to make more dough. I forgot what playlist I'm playing on Spotify. If y'all have any recommendations for a specific playlist, this one was made for me, so it's getting a little ethereal, and I might have to change it. Let's do something else. Okay. So, we're mixing. I think I added more so that we can get a few more dumplings out of this. Other than watching, yes, Jenny Kim, supermarket wraps are too hard. That is a fact. That is a huge fact. I hate the supermarket dumpling skins, but I use them, you know, it's convenient. If you want to use it, let me show you. Like any good cooking show, I have prepared dumpling skins. So I bought these just in case. I don't know. I like somehow botched the skins, or you just want to see the difference. I'll let you compare sort of the difference between fresh made skins and these kind of dried packaged dumpling skins later. What's cool about the dumpling skins though, if you do buy them, and this is like food in the time of quarantine, you can freeze dumpling skins and they'll thaw out really nicely. So, you know, if you like want to go to the Asian grocery store, you want to buy a bunch of dumpling skins or wonton skins, feel free to. It'll freeze up nicely. You could even freeze these up if you, you know, put enough like flour in between each one. So that's just a good tip in case you don't want to immediately make all of the dumpling skins at once, you know? And, you know, you should feel fortunate if you have enough pantry space and refrigerator space. Okay, so this is what's happening. I'm gonna get my hands in there just to make sure I can see what's going on. Oh yeah, it's soft. Do you see how kind of soft it is? It's come together nicely. I actually prefer it to be a little bit on the wet side just to start, because what we're gonna do is we're gonna knead it. And as we knead, if it feels a little too gummy, we can just keep adding flour, right? So once it kind of comes together a little more, I would put it out onto your whatever surface you're using. And now here's the fun part. The fun part is the key to a good dumpling skin, which really annoys me when people don't do this. Oh, it's going to start shaking when I knead, but oh well. Uh-oh. Okay. It's like a little earthquake here. Here, I'll try to... Okay, so you see how it's getting sticky? That's where you know it's time. But yeah, I like to start it off kind of on the wet side because it's easier to manage. It's actually, you don't want to knead something that's too hard, because what's going to happen is once you start kneading it, it's going to develop a gluten. And that's what you want. It's going to have its own elasticity. It's going to become harder itself without, you know, making it too dry. And also, when you're kneading it, you don't want it to be too hard to knead. But obviously, this little baby needs a lot more flour. So, yeah. So the key for me is making sure that you knead it enough to develop enough gluten. By the way, here's another little tip. Here's another little tip. Okay. Another tip is to keep this cutting board from moving. This is just a general person who cooks a lot tip. Wet a dishcloth. Wet the dishcloth, pop it underneath. And then it won't slide. Isn't that clever? Okay. All right. How y'all doing over there? So Barbara's asking, wax paper for freezing fresh? Yes, I would say wax paper is a really good idea. Even parchment paper, I think, would work, right? And honestly, I know some of y'all are probably, you know, fellow dumpling makers. So if you're in the comments, please feel free to let everyone else know how you do it. You know what I mean? Yeah. Y'all are the best. I'm just gonna make sure I get to view a little more. If you're just joining, this is Pasta Ho Jenny. I am a hoe for dough. That's the tagline I decided. And I decided I wanted to experiment with using a YouTube live stream because, I don't know, technology. And in case I want to do future live streams. And, did you guys see the texture right now? I think I need more. So yeah, I like going from sort of wet to dry. Hi, Jessica. Oh, good. If y'all are drooling, I would highly suggest that right now you put in an order to like have some dumplings delivered to you. What I love about, I'm trying to actually not shake the table that much. So if I show you how much I would actually put my back into like kneading the dough, it'll shake the camera, but it's almost like I'm pushing through the dough so that I can mix everything up and really, really give it a beating. You know what I'm saying? We're wrestling. We are wrestling with the dough. This is how I do it. Yes. Okay. Obviously, still too wet. Yes. Picture in picture. Listen, thank you, Jessica. I really tried hard to make sure I'm giving you some production quality. I bought a dough scraper, but in the meantime, this is what we're doing. Making it rain. Okay. Yeah, this is how I would knead. You really want to push it. This is a good song. But yeah, right now it's very early days here on this dough. You want to make sure the texture is not gummy like this, how it just separates. It's all kind of pockmarked looking. Yeah, I would highly recommend if you're hungry to order some dumplings right now so it'll get here in time for us to start wrapping them. As you guys might know, right now because the origins of the coronavirus being from China, there's been a lot of anti-Asian racism. And even when it wasn't really hitting America as strongly quite yet, the Chinatowns in like Asian neighborhoods in general, not just Chinatowns, were already getting hard hit with a reduction in business. So I think other than supporting your favorite local businesses who are still open and doing delivery, I think it's also cool if you're nearby like an Asian restaurant to support them and order pickup or delivery. All right, I think we're in business. Do you see how the dough is starting to come together? It's not sticking as much, right? We're working, you know what I mean? We are working, we're doing things. I'm showing you how I make my dough. So as I'm pushing through, it's starting to become more incorporated. And I like that as I push, it's like giving me a way, like it's almost like I'm pushing to the point where there's like a hole in the middle. Does that make sense? Yeah. Yeah. this is basically the consistency that I grew up watching my mom doing, which is to knead it pretty wet because it's easier to add flour than to take out water. Does that make sense? To take out flour. Ugh. It's easier to add flour than to take out flour. If that makes sense. When you add water when it's too dry, it's just kind of a goopy, weird. I don't know. It's just easier to add flour. Oh, good. So Barbara asked. Okay, so I didn't know to knead so intensely. Yes, because literally if you were to just make dough right now, make potstickers right now, do you see the texture? Do you see some of that texture? How it's sort of craggly and like kind of pockmarked. There's no smoothness. There's no shine. We're waiting until we get some smoothness and shine, basically. You know what I mean? Yeah, you definitely want to knead this maybe 5 to 15 minutes and then let it rest. You know, growing up, honestly, I did not let the dough rest in the middle of the kneading process. But I did learn later that that actually cuts down on the active kneading that you have to do. So you can let this rest. I'm going to let it rest after I knead. But I would say to show you how I grew up doing it, I'm just going to continue kneading until it gets shiny. I'm not going to let it rest and then knead again. Does that make sense? Yeah, I'm just going to keep kneading because that's how I grew up doing it. And as you can see, it's starting to come together a lot more. I'm pushing it. Yeah. Y'all, social isolation is its own thing, man. I'm an extroverted person. I'm used to seeing people a lot. I mean, I do also need downtime, but honestly, I think I'm very lucky that, because I don't have a pet, I'm very lucky that I actually have a roommate because, you know, it means that I'm like not seeing people in general. And I'm like, to my roommate, Ella, I'm like, oh, you better limit your social interactions because what happens to you happens to me. Oh, it's happening, guys. Do you see it? Do you see it starting to come together? Still a little wet, but it makes it easier to knead. I'm also very close to the camera right now because I'm kneading. Uh-oh. Next song. I think it's time for a little more dough. That's the cool thing is like as you knead and it comes together, it starts, the wetness will still reveal itself. You know what I'm saying? The wetness will reveal itself is a good rule of thumb in life. So I'm just incorporating some of that dough. Some of the flour. As you can see, it's starting to get shiny. Look at that. So this is what I'm going to do. I'm also going to pause because I'm also doing Instagram video. Y'all, this is a lot. This is a lot of work. I'm going to do video. This way you guys can see more of a close-up. Look it. This is about what? 5 minutes of kneading? So how many potstickers will this make approximately? That's the question, right? Aw, hello at phone Gemini. This is making you miss your mom's dumplings? I know. This, you know, making dumplings together as a family is such a big part of growing up when you're, I feel like, in the Chinese diaspora. So I don't know. I feel like it's good if you're able to carry on the tradition, you know what I'm saying? In terms of how much this is going to make, I mean, just imagine like one of these for a smaller Taiwanese style dumpling, one of these is not that big. Like, this is about the amount. This is my hand. I have beefy working hands. This is about how much one of the dumplings are going to be. So if you kind of estimate visually, you know, 1, 2, 3 rows, maybe 40. We'll see. I'm guessing 40. Maybe I'm going to be grossly underestimating it. But do you remember those games where you would look at a filled jar of beans or a filled jar of jelly beans and you had to guess what it is for like a birthday party? I feel like that's what that feels right now. It made me very nervous. I always wanted to get the answers right. So I definitely spent a lot of time looking at the jars of jelly beans to make sure I could get the best spatial analysis of how much I think is in each square inch of a jar of jelly beans. I don't know. Jessica says we're getting. Okay, everyone can guess. Wow, yeah. At Phone Gemini's guessing 60 to 70 dumplings. I'm guessing about 40. I don't know about you all. Please feel free to guess. Jessica says we're getting a BTS look into Jenny Yang content. Content does not come easy. That is fact, y'all.
Content does not come easy.
Do you like how, like, every time I need, it's just, you're just all up in my grill? We're just gonna keep kneading. Why rest? You know what I'm saying? Why rest? No rest. No rest. Yeah, if you can share, yes, your history with dumplings and what you grew up eating, what your dumpling traditions are, maybe if you have a specific type of filling, perhaps, or a style of dumplings that you like to eat. I know Jessica is talking about kimchi dumplings with clear noodles and tofu. And also Jessica's guessing about 53 dumplings. I like how precise that is, 53. You know, she walks to the beat of her own drum, marches. I don't know American idioms. Listen, I'm an immigrant. I might know English really well, and that's what I do for a living is write. But I don't know American idioms. Like, she marches to the beat of her own drum. Yeah, see? I said she walks. Oh. Na Kwang Nguyen said, at least you have less boogers than my son, so it's not that distracting. That's good. Thank you. I try to keep it clean up there. So if you can see how much, like, more energy and, like, strength I need now, we're developing the gluten. To me, this is the best part and the most important part of a good dumpling. Like, yeah, the filling's important, you know what I'm saying? But, man, I could visually tell when someone made dumplings that they did not develop enough of the gluten in their dumpling skin. And it's like, it matters. You know, I grew up, like, I feel like most kind of Asian families or immigrant families, like, food is just completely another currency, you know what I mean? Or another way that we show love. And that's like the thing that we are obsessed with in talking about in my family, at least, because we didn't talk about anything else. Anyways, so, literally, like, every time we ate food, whether it was out or, you know, the stuff that we make, we would comment on all the details, like, obsessively. Like, why is this dumpling skin different? Why does this taste better? You know what I'm saying? I know. I'm getting strong, everyone. Who's keeping track of how long I've been doing this? I've been kneading for maybe 10 minutes, 15? We're still getting sticky, y'all. I'm so glad I bought another bag of flour. That would be awesome if I had made this for you all, decided to live stream, and didn't have enough flour. Okay. We're almost there, y'all. We're almost there. Starting to get a little more gluten-y. So the word for in Chinese that we use, at least in Taiwan, I think it's elsewhere. Let me know if you use this. The word for elasticity for eating, for food, is Q, like the letter Q. So whenever we eat something that's like involving dough or noodles or pasta or like buns, especially the kind that, I don't know, is supposed to be like this, which is most sort of dough-based items, I would say, is if it's Q. Yeah, you'd be like, 这个很Q吗? You know what I'm saying? Yeah, Q is the best. That's basically elasticity. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to achieve a very Q elasticity. That's my dance face, sorry. Right there. Jessica said, watching this makes me think a dumpling making contest would not be ridiculous to add to the Olympics. That's true. At least a Pan-Asian Olympics. Lumpia versus Taiwanese versus Korean versus Japanese. Yeah, Q is a very Taiwanese description. Yeah, I don't think it's elsewhere, right? Yeah, please share with each other the kind of fillings that you guys do. I just have a basic pork and cabbage filling with a lot of scallion and sesame oil. Yeah. Ooh. It's coming together. You know what? I might do a little break so that we could put together the filling, yeah? And then we'll come back and knead it more. So if you can see here, it's starting to form a little more of a sheen. Slightly, right? See how it's coming together? Here, I'm gonna take a photo of this. Time for a little break, y'all. Next song. We're gonna let this baby rest. I would put a little like wet cloth on it or some plastic wrap. But it's coffee time. So tell me, yeah. What's everyone's experiences with making dumplings or potstickers? It's a little honey biscuit that I'm eating. Oop. Wait a minute. Gloria of Glee said, some Taiwanese sacha sauce, it's really good in the filling. I have that sauce. Maybe I'll put some today. That is very smart. Barbara really loves the kind with Chinese celery and pork. Tina said, last year we had a dumpling-themed Thanksgiving where we did turkey cranberry sage dumplings. What? What? How? How? That sounds so good. How did you do it? Please tell me, Tina. Okay. Let me cover this up and I'm gonna show you how I'm gonna make the filling. Thank you. I can't find my pork. Don't tell me I put my pork in here. Can't find my pork. Oh my gosh. Y'all, that was very dramatic, and I'm sorry. But I found the pork. All right, I'm gonna change the playlist. Cover this with some plastic wrap. Yeah, transition, baby. Two camera transition. It's probably too many N-words for a transmission. Here we go. Just gonna cover this baby up. While we make our filling, let it rest because I've been putting it through a lot. Ooh, okay. This is filling time. So I probably bought too much pork, but. I'm gonna do one pack. This is 80% lean pork, shoulder butt. Pork butt's the best. Actually, yeah, let's do it here because this is the only place where y'all can see it. I'll be sure to clean the cutting board before we keep going. Okay, we're going to do, this is what we're going to do. We're going to have about a pound of ground pork. This should make about 50, which is what a few of us have guessed this might make. We're going to do a pound of ground pork, 3/4 pounds of white cabbage, finely diced, about 3 garlic cloves, finely minced, half an inch of ginger, grated, 1 tablespoon of soy sauce, 1 teaspoon of sesame oil, 1/4 teaspoon of salt, 1/8 teaspoon of sugar, 1 pinch of white or black pepper, and then, you know, mix it all up. But I'm going to modify that. I'm using a reference guide under Taiwanese Potstickers. It's done by a blogger named Curious, what's your name? Curious Nut. I really liked Curious Nut's Taiwanese Potsticker recipe as a good base for like ratios and stuff. So if you look that up under curiousnut.com/Taiwanese-potstickers, that's where you can find it. So we don't want to mix it too much. I think there's like different rules of thumb about that. You know, like do you mix it a lot so it gets really gummy, etc. But we have about a little over 1 pound of ground pork. And then let's cut some cabbage. All What do you think is a 3/4 pounds of cabbage? How about that? I actually like a lot of cabbage. If you really want to stretch your meat, you can actually make most of this finely chopped cabbage. So there's really no way to go wrong on that. Okay. Are we still enjoying my light show? Whoop! What happened? Rearranging my windows here so I can see everything. All right, here we go. Oh, okay, yeah, Chinese celery and pork is really good. Last year, oh, right, Dad makes the best pork and Napa cabbage dumplings. Tina says, okay, so for the Thanksgiving dumplings, Tina says, one pound of ground turkey, sizzled leek or in scallion oil, dried cranberry handful, and duck fat because turkey is too lean. That's the question I had. When you said those ingredients, I was like, how is that actually good? And the dumpling, duck fat is the answer. Na Kwong Win asks, is there one canonical way to cook these when you are done making them, or is it equally kosher to steam, boil, and fry? If you missed what I said at the top, I would say Taiwanese-style dumplings, especially when it's a pot sticker, is specifically made so that it can be pan-fried. It's a little thinner. There's also a way where you can fry it. But what I would say is if you really wanted to boil dumplings, I would say make sure you have slightly thicker skin. If you want to steam it, you're not going to be doing that sort of very intrusive, fully surrounded, you know, roiling and boiling water kind of cooking. So I think it's okay to sort of do it with the thinner skin, but I would say the preference is to do thinner skin for everything except if you boil, because when you boil, it's more likely that the rigors of the boiling process will try to make the skin break open, and you don't want that. We're too good for that. Here, pasta hojin. All right, so we're chopping. I don't know what's the best way to chop. You just chop. And you want this to be fine, so let me do slices. You want fine chopped cabbage, because otherwise you really get the sort of texture in your mouth, and you don't want it to be too grainy. You want it to be all like one nice meatball. You know what I'm saying? Essentially, we're just wrapping meatballs with wrappers. What is this song? This is a very rockin' song. I don't like this song. I'm gonna change this song. There we go. So I'm trying to mince this kind of small. Some people actually might quickly blanch their and cook or stir fry, I mean. Their cabbage so that it's already soft. I'm of the mind that it's like one less step, you know what I mean? Especially if you can chop it kind of finely. I'm gonna do my best, y'all. I'm gonna do my best to chop this very finely. If not, I'm the only one eating this, but I think the more fine, the better. Honestly, if you wanted to, I mean, you could maybe do this in like a grater, like the thickest setting for a grater. You know what I'm saying? Because what it does is it does add moisture and a little texture. So you don't want to, you know, chop the heck out of the texture. But having it very finely chopped is a good thing. I sound like Martha Stewart. I hope that answered your question, Nock, about whether it's cool to steam, fry, or boil a dumpling, depending on how you make it. So I'm just mincing up the filling here. I mean, this is like a quarter pound, right? I don't know, y'all. We're eyeballing. And like I said, you can also use more cabbage than what the recipes say, because that's if you really want to stretch your meat. You know what I mean? She said, okay. Listen, this is not a cooking show made for kids. I'm just trying to make sure all of the sort of harder, whiter parts of the cabbage are chopped up. I think we're getting close, right? Do you see how the minceness is happening, the mincing? If you're snacking on anything right now, please let me know. Aw, Tina, you can cook however you like, depending on your mood and the dishes you're doing later. I think that's true too. I like to give finesse in my answers. Thank you, Tina. Knife techniques class, thanks. You know, I'm just trying to like educate the people. This is a very small cooking area. Usually I would spread out, but because we're keeping it on camera, I'm trying to keep it clean. So yeah, we're basically able to kind of run the knife through like this. This way, if you hold it down at the top, you can kind of get it together in a smaller area. Okay, that's a pretty good enough kind of a dice, right? I'm trying to show the camera, but I don't really know how to do it. Amy RR says that they're feasting on the first pork chop you ever made. That's nice. Okay, so this is probably a quarter pound. I can already kind of feel the water. If you wanted to, it depends on what your sort of philosophy is on what the dumpling filling is. Some people might even like squeeze out some of the water of a cabbage. I don't care. Do I want more? Let's just make a little more. The thinner you can slice it to start, the easier the actual dicing is going to be. Ooh, first pork chop ever. Yeah, how did you cook it? How did you cook that pork chop? Taiwanese pork chop. Honestly, I haven't made Taiwanese pork chop in so long. I used to make it with my mom. The key with Taiwanese pork chop, I feel like, is just like pounding it out so it's flat and thin and then frying it up really fast. I think you gotta cook it with some cornstarch, right? Like coat it with some cornstarch. And maybe five spice powder. Yeah, it's been a long time since I made Taiwanese pork chop with my mom. Yeah, so this got a pretty good dice because we started out pretty finely. You guys like this song? This is a very popular song. It's a solid pop song. Okay, I think we're pretty close with the cabbage, yeah? Now, if I was like a hardcore cooking show, I would have already chopped some so I didn't have to put you through all of this. But you know what? This is my first live stream, y'all. I hope it's good. That's not a fish for compliments. I do know that I'm showing you quality content. Oh my goodness. Okay. I'm gonna make sure my lighting is on my face. Honestly, to make sure that everything's seasoned right, I'm gonna start putting salt on this now. Not now, early. Because I put salt too early right now, now that I think about it. What it'll do is it'll make the cabbage leach water, and I don't think we want to do that. Wait a minute. What is this that I'm hearing? Na Huang Wen said, Jenny, I gotta go. Aw, but I'm gonna have your old Swarthmore friend, Jake Young, tell Jake Young about my video. Thank you. So you're the knock that I know. Wait, do I know you? And you'll make these dumplings. Yes. The two of you met in Seattle when I did my show in Renton. That's right. Well, hello, yes. We've met before. Anyway. So yeah, this is the filling. Let's make sure we add some other stuff. Garlic cloves and ginger. So I don't know if y'all know this, but a way for you to actually get a piece of ginger ready is to scrape it with a spoon. See that? How the skin is so thin? Ooh, let me show you. My God, it smells so good. The skin just comes right off. Look at that. Okay, so I'm not gonna mince it. I'm actually just gonna grate it. It's supposed to be grated anyway, so. I'm gonna use a microplane. We're supposed to put in about a half an inch, so this is probably too much, but you know. Oh, fresh ginger is so good. See how that? Might be a little overexposed. There we go. So here's a question. Have we talked about favorite dumpling combos? Oh, yes. Pork and leek is your favorite, for sure. No, my favorite is the classic, which is a pork and cabbage. I also really like, how to put it? What is it called? Chives. I love a pork and chive as well. All right, I think I put about a half an inch of the grated ginger. Half an inch of a knob. Lots of ginger flavor. There we go. Okay, now we have ginger. Let's put in some garlic cloves. Honestly, I kind of want to cheat. So what I'm going to do garlic powder. I'm gonna put in garlic powder. I love garlic powder so much. It's like such, if you don't have fresh garlic, literally just have this in your pantry. Garlic powder and onion powder, pepper and salt, and you can make everything. So I'm gonna hit it with some garlic powder. I'm too lazy to chop up garlic. I have garlic. That's a lot of garlic powder. Fuck it. Okay. And then we got a tablespoon of soy sauce. I like a dark soy sauce, especially for filling, because, I don't know, I like the caramelness. And I bought this recently at H Mart. If you're just tuning in, thank you so much for tuning in and hanging out with me on a Saturday quarantine cooking edition. Pasta Ho Jenny's out here. We're making Taiwanese style potstickers, and what makes it Taiwanese style, as we have discussed, is the thinner skin, slightly smaller. Sometimes it's oblong, but for the most part, I'm making sort of a half crescent style. Right now, we're doing the filling while the dough rests for a few minutes. So this calls for about over a pound of pork that I have here, 1 tablespoon of soy sauce. I'm just going to eyeball it. Right? That's about a tablespoon. I like this stuff. So y'all, anyway, this is Pearl River Bridge Superior soy sauce, dark soy sauce. And then a teaspoon of sesame oil. Quarter teaspoon of salt. I'm gonna use the salt, the sea salt, the kind of flaky salt that I got from a to-go Korean, like, soup, oxtail soup situation. What do we say? Quarter teaspoon? Nah. A little more. Sugar. I never put sugar. I never put sugar, but might as well. I'm slightly following. This is coconut sugar. Just a pinch. Okay. And then white or black pepper. I like a lot of pepper, so I'm gonna put in a lot of black, white pepper. Still gotta make that Instagram content, y'all. Photo time. Just white pepper. I like a lot of it. I'm also gonna add some red pepper. I like this brand of different peppers. Classic. Ooh, that's a lot. Okay, what are we doing? Are we mixing yet? I think we're mixing. So I think that's pretty much it for my dumpling stuff. So I think it's time to mix. Let's get in here. Truly the best tool is a pair of chopsticks and your hands, but I'm trying to keep it a little loose right now. Right now it smells so good. I can smell the fragrance of the sesame oil. I'm getting a hit of that white pepper for sure, and even the garlic powder. Honestly, I wouldn't mind adding both black pepper powder and white pepper powder. Oh my God, smells so good. The smell of this, of the ginger and the garlic and sesame oil, is literally the smell of childhood. Ugh, and soy sauce. Do you see how it's really coming together? I would definitely want to make sure everything's pretty well mixed. As you can see, there's still little pieces. So I think I'm going to get my hands in there. Yes, dark soy sauce, baby. It's all about that coloring, you know? It's like we first eat with our eyes, so gotta make it appetizing. You know what? I'm gonna avoid using my hands because I don't want to wash them. Have y'all been washing your hands so much? I'm gonna wash them, but have you been washing your hands so much? Your hands are all dry now. I just want to mush the meat in and incorporate it a lot more before we work on the dough again. Amy RR says, I've been realizing lots of Taiwanese style dishes require sugar. I mean, kinda. I think to varying degrees. Definitely, there's a lot of sweetness and sourness. It's like a lot of influence from different regions, I would say. My friend Clarissa Wei, who is an awesome food reporter, right now writes for Gold Thread, which is a part of the South China Morning Post over in Hong Kong. She and I did a tour of different regions to kind of learn the differences in the regional food in mainland China. And yeah, it was very educational. And definitely there's certain parts where it's like you slide the dial on like how something is sugary or not, depending on which region you are. Okay, check this out. This is looking pretty good, don't you think? Oh, you know what I forgot, which was not in the recipe that I'm using? Scallions. I like to add some scallions. Give it some scallions and then we're gonna get back to the dough. How y'all doing? Huh? Pretty good? We've shared what kind of potstickers we like. Yeah, what are your experiences with making potstickers? Because honestly, it varies. Yeah? I feel like dumpling skin is like the easiest. You know what I'm saying? Like just to buy it, which I get. Where's my trash bowl? I don't have a trash bowl. Bring it. Okay. To be a good immigrant, I need to use all of this. So I'm not gonna discard the ends. I'm gonna chop the ends as well. Just wanna make sure I cut it vertically first so that it could be a little easier to do like a finer chop. Don't cut your nails off. Whew. So glad I'm doing this, honestly. Let me get rid of this. It was a journey to produce this live stream because I actually have my big iMac that I had to set up last minute this morning because I thought I was going to do it on my laptop, but I realized when I like connected it to YouTube, it was not going to be cute. There was a lag, some weirdness. There's a lot of technical stuff with setting up a live stream, y'all. Especially a live stream that is I'm piping it through an encoder called OBS. If any of you want to do this yourself, because it is the time of live streaming now that we're all social quarantining. But, yeah, and you want to do, like, multiple cameras, and you want to, like, switch graphics. It's a really cool free application to do, to essentially start up your own studio. Chop, 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 chop. Gotta mint it. It's all about the texture, y'all. I don't know if you gather, but chopping is very important in, like, Chinese diaspora cuisine, you know what I mean? Taiwanese cuisine. Like, because we pick everything up with our chopsticks, and the texture, and you want it to be bite-sized already. And so that's why, like, Nice Skills in Chopping is, like, they do these, like, Chinese food chef competitions, and it's so cool. They, like, for sure, like, they get into it, you know? How to make, like, decorative melons and shit, but knife skills are so important for Chinese cooking. And getting just the right texture of stuff, you know? Ooh, the dough is almost ready to be kneaded again. Believe it or not, I actually have given a paid workshops in making dumplings, and now I'm doing it for free. Yeah, look at that. Free for a YouTube live stream. Now, what I am going to encourage you all is, if you feel like you've enjoyed some of this, I am accepting tips that I will be donating for sort of local mutual aid for either restaurant workers or for friends of mine who work in the creative industry. I'm actually saving all the tips from all of my live streams so that I can provide that for those who are the hardest hit in this economy. Okay. So there's a lot of water. I'm actually going to get a paper towel because I don't want too much water. But man, maybe next time I'll make scallion pancakes. It's actually very easy. Okay, so this is my addition to... scallion overboard to the recipe. There we go. BTS, baby, look at this. I'm gonna take a photo. Okay. How are y'all feeling? We're hanging, we're doing things. Ugh. This makes me so happy. I love potstickers so much. But do you see how it's, like, nice and brown? It kind of makes the filling look more appetizing, especially when we cook it up. Okay. So the filling is good to go. I'm so excited. All right. Cover this up. So yeah, the first time I actually taught people how to make pot stickers was in a workshop. It was a paid workshop, and I really enjoyed it. But now what I'm doing is I'm live streaming so that I can get tips on Venmo. If you Venmo me at Jenny Yang TV, and I'm going to do screenshots, obviously, for transparency. I'm going to donate that money that I'm earning from these live streams to relief efforts for hospitality and creative professional workers. Okay. We are out here, y'all. We are out here. Let me just clean my little workstation, you know what I'm saying? Clean my little workstation, get it ready for the dough. The dough. I think it might be time to pick up the music, because this is getting a little low. Okay, let's change the music. We're gonna work on our dough. Oh, I am so excited. Do you see how it's like relaxed a little bit? It's kind of chilled a little bit, a little chilled out for us. Yay. Feeling good. You just ate, but I'm definitely drooling, imagining the aromas that must be filling your kitchen. Thank you. Okay, I'm gonna change the song because this is too much. This is too slow. If there's any song requests, we're going to play music that will be a little more upbeat. You know what? Let's do Harry Styles. No? Maybe not Harry Styles. What are we doing? Let's do Solange. Yes. It's dough time. I think it's time for a dance break before we get into the dough. This is BTS. Listen, I'm making Instagram content. Look at that. So this, as you can see, because of the rest, you can see that the dough actually has shined up a little bit. All the glutens have kind of evened out, but we can actually knead it a little more. See how shiny it is? Oh, it's glossy. It doesn't easily kind of rip apart, but you see some of the texture, the cueness. Hey, Roni. Much love to you, too. Thanks to all the new people checking in. I know some folks are moving in and out of this live stream. This live stream will be archived. So now that I'm actually, after the dough rested, you can see it's shinier. I can feel the give and the elasticity a little more, like the little snapback. I love a good snapback. But you see how much shinier it is now? Ooh, ooh. My little ring light. I like to have it right there. There we go. Look at that. Solange is the best. What's up, Brent W? Oh my God, is that an actual dab emoji? Look it on the comments. Brent W put on a dab emoji. Oh my God. All the talk of Q does make me want to have bubble tea. Maybe I should order some bubble tea, y'all. What do you think? Ugh, the elasticity, the Q-ness is happening, the Q factor.
Ugh, I'm pushing it.
Look at that. See the bounce back now? The gluten. I'm gonna let the gluten rest a little more, and then I think we'll be ready. Because it's getting there, huh? After just a few more minutes. So we probably needed this for about 10 to 15 minutes to start, and then we let it rest for about 15 minutes or 10 minutes. And now I'm kneading it again, just to make sure we're gonna get all the gluten's forming. Because that, my friend, is the key to a delicious, there's all this like noise, to a delicious potsticker. It's really a lot in the skin. Oop. Honestly, I could knead this more. But I want you all, because I want you all to see the shininess. But it's already developing. It's good. Okay. We're gonna let this puppy rest for a little bit more. Well, I take a quick break. How does that sound? It's time for a little break. So we're just gonna have a little 5-minute intermission and then we'll be right back so that, we can start making dumplings. I'm gonna show you my technique for how to roll out these dumpling skins. Okay, so 5 minutes, I'll be back. The music will still be playing and I'll see you soon, yeah? You might hear some noise in the back, but this is what it is. I'll see you in 5 minutes.
I hope you find your way. Sorry we couldn't make it. Still I miss you anyway. Yeah, I just grew and couldn't break it. I always thought it was enough for my own heart. Sometimes I swear it was enough for my own heart. Guess I'll wait another lifetime. I guess I'll wait another lifetime. I know how to make mistakes. Wasn't grown enough to fake them. Everybody makes mistakes. Do we live a lot to break them? How I wish I was good enough for our part. Don't ever think you are enough.
I just don't know. You're
We're back. I gotta finish tying up my shirt. Okay, I appropriately put on my outfit again. Hey everyone, thanks for sticking with me while we were doing the intermission. Oh my gosh, we're out here, we're doing it. It's time. It's time to turn on the light. Oh my goodness, y'all. I'm a one-woman show here. I'm producing it. I'm lighting it. I gotta remember to light my own show. There we go. How's everyone doing? I'm gonna turn down the music. If you're back with me, give me a little wave. And I think it's almost time, y'all, to show you how to actually I am nonverbal now. I took a break, I went to the bathroom, I cleaned things up, I set up for cutting dough and making dumpling skins. So if you're ready, give me a shout out, you know, just a little shout out in the comments that you're there. Maybe you took a break. Maybe you had a snack. I forgot to take my allergy medicine. Anyway, kitchen cabbage patch. Oh, good. A little wave. I like that. Now the secrets of the skin, the great Barbara Gilbert secrets of the skin. So, let's just make sure we have our camera looking good. Yeah, I think it's aimed at a pretty good angle. Okay, here we go. So as you can see, this puppy, it's shinier. It's not as shiny as I usually like it, but it is shinier. The way I set everything up right now is I have some extra all-purpose flour. I have our rested dough, a little. So this specific, I'm gonna turn this down. This is too much for me. Okay, so this specific, I don't know. It's like a dowel style rolling pin. It's really not that thick. It's maybe an inch and a half in diameter. What's really good is that it's very nimble and there's a lot of this motion. And so that's what's actually really perfect for making a lot of Chinese cuisine, Taiwanese cuisine, potstickers. So we have the dough, we have the flour, we have the rolling pin. And now I'm just gonna knead it out a little bit and then I'll show you. I also set up some this little sheet pan with some parchment paper on it over here. I'm gonna dust some flour on the bottom because this is where we're gonna rest our skins and eventually our finished wrapped dumplings. Gotta have a place to put them. Okay, whew. We're here, we're lit. Are we lit? We're lit. Okay, let me roll this out a little bit. Roll this out a little bit. Let me knead it a little bit just to kind of see what's up. You see how shiny it is now? I love it, it's so shiny. Smack that. Anyway, I enjoy that too much. You know what I'm saying? Okay. All right. All right, Jenny. Let's take it down a notch. All right. Let's just take it easy. All right. Jenny Kim's ready. Barbara Gilbert. Jennifer Kuo's ready. Brent's ready. Hopefully Tina Ye is back soon. What's up, Ronnie? Okay. So look at that. This is a beautiful piece of dough. I'm so proud of us. We did this together. Okay. So what I would do is, let me make sure I have the plastic wrap. I'm going to just cut, I don't know, a fifth of this. We don't need to get too intense with it for now. I'm going to wrap it just to make sure that the rest of the dough is covered and it won't dry out. But this is what we're going to work with to get started. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to roll this out into a long strand, a relatively thin rod, honestly, because like I said, the Taiwanese style potstickers tend to be kind of on the smaller and thinner side in terms of the skin. So I'm going to try to make this actually pretty, pretty thin. Is this the better technique? No. Like I said, I haven't done this in a while. But yeah, just keep on doing this. It's, as you can see, it's pretty elastic now at this point. You know what I'm saying? Do I put it on this side? Let's put it on this side. There we go. I want this thinner. Pretty uniform. Now, if we had a dough scraper, this would be a good time to do the cutting. This is the dumpling cutting time. Whew. So elastic. Keep going. Really stretch her out. Okay. I think this is pretty good. Try to make it kind of even. Yeah. This part is a little thin in the middle, but you know. We'll make do. Okay, so can we see it? Can we see it? Yes. I'm gonna make sure you can see it. Here we go. Oh, there we are. That's what we got to do. This is how you're gonna see everything. Okay, so I'm gonna just take a chef's knife and do the cutting over here. What I like to do is put a little pile of flour so that when I'm done cutting, I can kind of toss it so that it's not that. So here's a technique on this. It almost looks like we're making gnocchi, if you've ever made gnocchi. I want these little things to become round. So one technique that's cool is when you cut one direction, and then you give it a quarter turn like that. Do you see that? How I gave it a quarter turn so that I'm cutting against it so that it turns out you have one cut that makes it narrow in one direction, and then it gets narrow in the other direction. Do you see that? In a weird way, it actually makes it easier to make it kind of round later. It's just a small little tip from Mama Yang. What is this? Okay. That doesn't look right. Throw that out. I think I've got some, like, junk on it. Okay. There we go. So the thin part in the middle, I made it so it's slightly longer. Otherwise, the fatter parts, I made it narrower so that you still pretty much have the same size. And I like to, like, kind of pop them into the, especially the sticky side, pop them into the flour so they don't stick to each other. This one's a little small, but I think we'll figure it out. All right. Let's give some to this one. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Who loves Robin? Amy's back too, good. So you see how I kind of smashed it down? Because of the cut where I like do the sort of, you know, 45 degree turn every cut, it makes it so it's easier to make it a circle rather than an oblong. All right, are you ready, y'all? I'm gonna show you the way that Mama Yang taught me how to roll this stuff out. Oh, okay. Make sure you have the light here. Okay. Watch carefully. I'm actually going to turn off my face. Going to turn off my face so that you can see only this. So right now we have a relatively small little sand dollar of a piece of dough. And what I'm going to do is I'm gonna hold my little rolling pin slightly to the right. So you see how I'm not in the middle. I'm slightly to the right. And what it does is it allows me to see what's happening in the middle. But a lot of the pressure is kind of being pushed over here on the center, right? Because that's where my dough is. So when you do this well and fast and when you're good, you can do this in three quick steps, so three pushes. But I'm gonna show you the regular rate, so I'm not gonna slow down quite yet. See how that took about four? I can make it, this is still a little thick. So I'm gonna keep going. So it doesn't stick, I have a little bit of flour on the side. Okay, so do you see how it's really spread out like that? It's a little thinner. What you want to do is you want to make sure that when you're pushing it, the center is just slightly not over thin. It's like slightly thicker, but not by much. So what's really important too is that because we got a really cute elastic dough, when we really give it the old, you know, the old push down, it won't tear. Do you see how I'm pushing it pretty hard down and it won't tear? So if you do this right and you turn, I'm a righty, so if you turn it sort of counterclockwise, a quarter turn every time you go in, go all the way to the center, then you're gonna get a nice thin dumpling skin. You see that? Are we seeing this? I hope we are. It's very cute, right? It's like a cute little dumpling skin. So I'm gonna show you on another one, but this is basically what we want right now. It's nice and thin when we actually go in and do the dumpling, which I'll show you my favorite fold. But this could even be thinner, honestly. These are kind of big. We could probably make them smaller, but this is great. Okay, so I just put some flour on the bottom and I set it to the side. Now we're gonna show you again. Roll in and out, quarter turn. In and out, quarter turn. You really want to put in a lot of pressure toward the center of the skin. It's sticking. There we go. It's nice and thin. Yeah, this looks big, right? We could probably make these smaller dumplings. Let's do these kind of bigger, and then I'll show you a smaller one. Because usually it doesn't take this much to like roll the dough for the dumpling, for the potstickers, or the dumpling skins, I mean. We will cut smaller ones next. Woohoo! Yeah. Oh well. Okay. I'm gonna cut these smaller. I'm gonna redo these. I'm gonna cut them smaller. Why? Because these are too big. This is too big for me. It can be a little smaller. And what's nice about the fresh dough and that it's kind of wet is that you can really, you know, reincorporate it together again pretty quickly. See that? Barbara Gilbert asks, do you press the gnocchi down from one of the cut sides? Yes. So I'll show you more specifically. So I'm gonna make these smaller. All right, here we go. Here we go, a smaller little dumpling skin. Okay. Let's make it smaller. Okay, so we have that. Quarter turn, quarter turn, quarter turn. Why does this have a hair in it? Come on, Jenny. Quarter turn, quarter turn, quarter turn, quarter turn. Yeah, this looks more like it. Okay. These are so little. They do look like little gnocchis. I love me some Robin. This is the Robin playlist. So Barbara asked, do you press the gnocchi down from one of the cut sides? And that's a yes. Because that's a way for you to mush it down so that it kind of evens out. Do you see how it's oblong on the bottom? But narrow in the other direction up top? So when you press it down, then it's more ready to go. In terms of being ready to make a circle. Okay, I'm gonna do a little photo of this because I'm also doing this for the Instagram. Okay, I'm gonna show you my face again. How are we doing? Yeah, so that is a useful tip. That's one of my favorite tips, so that when you press it down, it'll be nice and circular. All right, here we go, y'all. This is it. I'm gonna show you, this is a smaller little dumpling skin. Yeah. Smaller. We got it. This is much thinner. See, compare it with the first one that was so big. Look at that. But yeah, now I'm just going to do it kind of fast because I don't think you should watch me do all of these. I should clean this off because this is making things stick. Uh-oh. I don't want to cut the wood. Okay. I'm just pushing it toward the center, making sure. You can do a lot of work pushing in and pushing out. And of course, make sure it doesn't stick. Whoop! Look it, not perfect. But yeah, let's give it some flour on both sides. See how when I smash it down because of the 45 degree angle cut, every time I can smash it down to be basically a circle. You can really push it in from the edge. There we go. That's something. That's something. And it's okay if it's slightly oblong because you can make the dumpling that way with the filling. Concentrating so hard, y'all. But yeah, I grew up making these, and we got pretty fast actually at making dumplings. One person would do this. Oh, see, I didn't have enough flour. That makes it easier. One person would do this while other people would, you know, fill the dumplings. So this takes some practice. I've been doing this all my life, so. My friend Jaina actually texted me at the beginning of this live stream to remind me that one of the things that I did right when I graduated from college was invite my friends, because my parents were there, to make dumplings from scratch. And it was one of her favorite memories. Honestly, for me to make dumplings for you is a way I'm showing love. So that means whoever's watching, this is how I'm showing love. Yeah. So if you want to see right now, we have a few of these ready to go. Okay. So I'm going to just roll one more and then we're going to fill the dumplings so that y'all can, I don't know, get on with your day. We can actually see what's up. And I'll fry some up the way I fry it. This way you can see how I cook it too. Okay, see how thin this is? You can almost see it through the light. Content time. Okay, are you ready to fill? Give me a wave if you're ready to fill. Okay, keep this puppy on the side. By the way, I have these Shanghai dumpling wrapper. So these actually might be a little thinner. Like if you go to the supermarket and you see like Hong Kong style dumpling wrappers, usually it might be a little thicker. So if this is Shanghai or Taiwan, it might be thinner. You see how it's like thinner? Okay. I'll show you the difference between the fresh and the not fresh. Look at how thin that is. I feel like it's very similar to the Taiwan style. Do you see how thin that is? This is a perfect little factory disc, and this is made by me. Okay. Call your girlfriend. So let's fill, this is the technique I use for making a pot sticker. You ready? Ooh, there we go. Yeah. Ooh, ooh. I'll hold it right here. Come through lighting. Okay. Here we go. So the key for me, thanks for the comments to wave and say Phil. All right. So this is what we're doing. Is the focus pretty good? All right. Because it's kind of smaller, but I still like to fill it pretty well. And the skin is actually pretty elastic when you're using fresh dumpling skins. You can actually put a good amount. This is maybe a little more than a tablespoon, right? And actually, I can fill it even more, honestly. This is a more advanced, if you want to fill it much fuller, this is what it is. So this is almost like a tablespoon and a half. Now, I have a bowl of water here, but you don't have to use it when you have fresh dumplings skin. So this is what I would do. The key here is you pinch it in the middle. Do you see how, because it's fresh, it almost looks like a cannoli, right? And you want the bottom to rest so that it's about equally distributed, right? So that it has a little bottom to it. You squeeze it in the middle. Because it's fresh, it's like so easy to pinch it together. You don't really need a bowl of water to dip in, but if you needed to, feel free. And then what I do is I do the pleating technique where only the backside, this is the side away from me, right? Only the backside gets pleated. So it turns into this little crescent. So I do one fold, squeeze, another fold in, squeeze, final fold, squeeze. So it's three folds. See that? So same thing on this side. One fold, two folds, three folds. And because it's fresh, it's so forgiving. You can like kind of pull the skin around your big chunk of meat. You know what I mean? That's why you can almost overstuff what you think you can't handle in this tiny dumpling skin. But do you see how it's essentially two little meatballs in one dumpling? How's that look? Whew. So I just put some flour underneath, plop it over here on the sheet pan. Now, let me show you how to do that with a pre-made dumpling skin. This is, what is this brand? Shanghai style dumpling wrappers, which are thinner. And it's more dry, you see that? So I'm gonna put my little filling here. This is slightly less than what I put actually in my dumplings. Yay, you saw it. Okay, so look, if I, with this dumpling, the Shanghai style wrapper, if I tried to close it without water, it's really hard. Like I literally had to like pinch so hard. So it'll just make your life easier if you can just like, I don't know. So look, you see how stiff that is? It's so stiff. Yeah, the folds are not easy, but it takes practice. So I'm gonna use a little water to kind of dab along this side and on the outside here, because the pleating to me is really pretty. Oh my God, do you see how it's like already squeezing out? There's like zero elasticity because it's not fresh. So I'm just gonna try to close it without the pleats. So yeah, I just closed it without the pleats because it's so inelastic. I'm gonna try to do one pleat over here so it's symmetrical. Actually, I need water. So yeah, so this is a little side-by-side comparison of using fresh versus not fresh dumpling skins. And I just think it's much easier to just make some dough and like get her done, you know what I mean? Yay, I'm so glad you feel inspired, Amy. So yeah, this is my like factory made wrapper version of pot stickers. This is with the Shanghai style wrapper. But it's serviceable. It's just very dry. So you see how much work that took. This is our big one from the beginning. I'm going to show you the pleats with a big one so you can see the pleating process a little more. Yeah? So it's so elastic, I can put in so much meat in the middle. I'm going to take some out because I want you to see the pleating a little more. Okay. So do you see how I probably could put in more meat? So you just squeeze the middle so it looks like a cannoli, right? It's like sits equally distributed weight-wise. Then all you're doing is folding in on one side, one fold, two folds, three folds, and then just kind of finish it off. Yeah, you see that little, the folds? More examples, yes. Left side, two, three. I'm using my sort of in like my ring fingers and my pinkies to hold the bottom while I use my index finger and my thumb to do the pleating up top. So you see how it looks like little, it looks like old gold ingots. That's what dumplings used to look like, little gold ingots, like old school style. So this one you can kind of see, it's like a little half crescent moon shape. Yep. Okay, let's do another big one from earlier. More examples of folding. And then I'm going to show you how I pan fry. There is a whole technique with pan frying where you can get more crust on the bottom, you know, the really good stuff. I don't really do it. Oh, why am I dipping water? Okay, here we go. Okay, that's a good angle. So remember, you put it in your left hand if you're a righty. Just pull the middle parts together and squeeze so that that's how you get started, right? Like a little cannoli again. Let it rest in your hand. Now, all you have to do while it rests in the ring finger and your pinky, take your two active fingers here, fold in to the center, one pleat, second pleat, third pleat. And you just want to space it out. Other side. Using one finger to hold it down, you pleat it in, fold it. One finger to hold it down, pleat it in, fold it, pleat towards the center. That's it. So now you can see some of those folds in the back. Yeah? More examples. I'm gonna do the pleating and everything. And then we're going to do enough dumplings so that I can show you how I pan fry it. And then we're done. Thanks for joining me. This has been awesome. I know I'm kind of doing it fast, but you get it, right? But you see how it's so forgiving when you do fresh potsticker skins? Like, it's just so much easier than using like a stiff factory made one, which is still fine in a pinch. Pinch. I hope the filling's good. I hope I season, like that's the thing that I always like, is always a wild card for me, is how salty the filling is, because I always eyeball and sometimes I don't know. But you see how fast you can do it eventually. Eventually, the people who are hardcore dumpling makers, like back in the original Din Tai Fung when I was a child and I would go there and eat, they would have a window where these like old dudes would literally just put it a little dumpling skin on their hand with the filling. And with one press, with four fingers like this, just boom, done. And then they'd be done. Boom, done, boom, done. Like so many dumplings so fast. All right, let me just make a few more, and then we're going to go fry. Make four more. How about that? Fuck it. I'm going to do it fast so you can see a relatively full plate of finished potstickers. See, that just got a little messy, but we did it. Y'all need me to show you more slowly how to do the folds or what? Let me know. One more time, maybe. In the middle, cannoli. Pleat in the center. One, two, three. One, two, three. There it is. Woo. This one's a tiny one. A true test of a dumpling master. Look how messy that is. So forgiving. Fresh dumpling skins. Look at that. All done. Two more. Two more. Thank you for complimenting me on my pretty dumplings. Cannoli. Pleat one, pleat two, pleat three. Pleat one, pleat two, pleat three. Last one. Try to make sure the camera's on it. Okay, photo time. All right, cannoli in the middle, pinch it. Pleat toward the center, one, two, three. Pleat toward the center, one, two, three. Look at that. All done. Look at what we made. I don't know if you can see it. Oh, here we go. All right. I'm going to try to take you with me. I don't know how. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to bring over my pan so you can see how it looks. Yeah? That way, you can see how I cook it. I just won't be able to bring you over to the stove. So for this, you just want a flat bottom pan, ideally nonstick, lots of oil on the bottom, just a regular canola or vegetable oil. You want to heat it up, just rip roaring. You just want enough oil to coat the bottom pretty substantially, nothing too wild, because the technique that we use is sort of a steam and fry method, and that's how you're able to cook it so fast. Okay. How y'all holding up? Thank you for watching. We're almost toward the end. We're gonna wanna see what it looks like at the end, and I need to taste it to see if the salt was enough. I wonder if it's possible to zoom in on a FaceTime video camera. Is it? I don't know. Almost done. Almost done. Almost done. What is this gunk? Look at our cute little dumplings, guys. They're all different sizes, but you know, this weird Shanghai one is so smooth. There we go. Thank you, Brent. I did make it look easy. Just have to practice. Yeah, like the rolling technique, you definitely want to practice. Remember to, you know, turn and push, And then with the folding and pleating, it just takes practice. Cannoli in the middle, pleat toward the center, pleat toward the center. All right, I'm heating this up. So there is a technique, I don't usually do it, where you can throw in like cornstarch or tapioca starch in with the bottom of your whatchamacallit, your dumplings, so that when you fry it up, it'll also fry up this sort of full pan of crust. I don't really do it. It's fine. I get enough crust from the dumpling, you know. Okay. I threw in some flour and it's sizzling a little bit, so I'm just gonna pop these in. This is very dangerous. Don't do what I'm doing. I'm bringing you the pan so you can see what I'm doing. It's getting heated up. I like to put it in this pattern. This is a Mama Yang pattern. Is this too bright? This is too bright. If you want, they can actually be placed pretty close to each other. This isn't a full pan, but you get the picture. What I like to do is I like to do a very pretty, right next to each other in the middle, a row of dumplings, and then facing toward the center, a pattern of the dumplings on the side, on either side. See that? So the oil is hot, and this is not the end of the cooking. It's not just oil. You gotta add water. So add some water. It doesn't matter if it's cold or hot. Honestly, it could be cold water. But you definitely want a pan that has a lid. Okay, don't forget, because this is part of the steam fry process. So now that the oil is hot, I'm gonna put in a substantial amount of water, and usually I like to put in enough that goes up to like about, in a full pan, about slightly almost halfway up the height of the little dumpling. The heat is on high and the frying process is going to happen at the very end, because all of the water that I just poured in, that just sizzled, will actually steam through with the covered pan. Okay? Does that make sense? Jenny Kim says, you definitely made me realize that it's better to put some work into making the dough instead of using store-bought. Thank you. I'm selling it. Avoid some of the headaches of dealing with underfilled dumplings, which is usually the result of the skins being too hard. I agree. Barbara said, was totally intimidated by making homemade dough. This is so helpful and inspiring. Thank you. I'm so glad y'all kind of stayed with me to join me on this live stream. I was like, oh my gosh, if no one is going to make comments and have a conversation with me, then what am I even doing? But either way, this video is going to be archived so that hopefully other people will be able to see it. I'm also probably going to edit it down. And after I end this live stream, I will be making more Instagram posts so that I have more short clips, and I'll do more demos for that. So if you want to check it out on my Instagram at Jenny Yang TV, at hashtag PastaHoJenny under the highlights, it's right on the profile, you can see it. Hopefully I'll put it up by late tonight. Yeah, and if you liked and appreciated the cooking that I did and what I taught you, please consider tipping me at Jenny Yang TV. All of these live streams, whoever tips me, those tips, I'm going to aggregate it and I'm going to try to give it out to, plus my, with my own money to match it. I'm going to give it out to some creative friends who have recently lost their jobs, and also split it with some local Los Angeles, it's like mutual aid, sort of funds that help hospitality workers, and actually one that is also helping hospital workers to feed them. If you want to follow Thunderbolt LA or the Park's Finest, my friend John Eric Concordia, who has been amazing at pivoting his restaurant into serving donated foods and meals to frontline hospital workers, some of that money that you tip today will go towards that. There's also a fund at CCEDLA. If you go to Instagram, CCEDLA or CCEDLA.org online. In Los Angeles, it's the Chinatown Community for Equitable Development. And what they do is they organize working families. And if you tip me, I will also donate to their fund where they're trying to help the hardest hit working families of all ethnicities who live in the Chinatown neighborhood here in Los Angeles, which is actually, on average, a pretty low, much lower income kind of a neighborhood that I used to live in. And all of this I'll do screenshots and eventually post it so you can see some of that transparency. That's that though. Venmo Jenny Yang TV, even if it's $5, I'd appreciate it. So here's the other tip. The key to listening when the dumplings are done is listening to the sound. So right now the water is still going. You can still peek too, because if you have it on high heat, it'll just be roaring anyway because it's a thin layer of water. But the key is hearing when it starts to sizzle, because that's when you know the frying process is done and the steaming is done. So just the steam process itself, it's actually gonna cook the raw dough and the raw meat very quickly. That's why it's like, you know, from frozen, you can do frozen dumplings. And if you do this technique, it'll be just the same. I don't know why it baffles people that like it takes all this, like as if it takes all this cooking time to like cook anything. And it really is pretty fast. I actually don't own a microwave. So I don't know. I reheat things just on the stove. It's fine. And actually with steam. So you can't hear this, but I'm starting to hear some of the bubbles disappearing. The water, the steam. So I'm gonna open it. Yeah. Oh my goodness. I'm going to show you. Okay. Do you see? Right now there's still water. But you can see that essentially we've already steam cooked the dumplings. It's pretty much cooked. But what we're doing is we're going to evaporate the water so that we could do the frying. When I find myself having put too much water in, like right now, I probably have a little too much water because we've already cooked through the dumplings through the steam. I uncover it so that the steam can release much faster, and then we can get to the fry. You can also give yourself a facial. Yeah, we're making food in real time. You know what I mean? You're chilling. It's Saturday. It's been a long day. But you've been watching because I'm cooking the end of the pot sticker tutorial, the pasta ho Jenny tutorial of Taiwanese style dumplings. The frying is happening. And then we're going to taste it to make sure it's good. And then we'll wrap it up. And then I'm going to take a break. And then I'm going to make more dumplings for the Instagram. Ooh, photo. Woo! Woo! Okay, so we're toward the end of the water steaming off, so that's when there's less water and it's just a little water competing with the oil, it's gonna start popping. And so I'm gonna cover it. Or at least use my cover as a shield because I have exposed legs. But you do wanna keep the heat to be high because you want the steam to evaporate completely so we can start the frying process. And then you're done. I'm just balancing the lid so that it could still, the steam can still release, but we're still allowing the pops of the hot oil from jumping out. You hear it? It's very loud. It's frying. Let me get my plate ready. It's frying. I'm gonna take a photo so that you can see it later on Instagram. So close. So close. Okay. I think it's close. Thank you for the tip. I just got one. Let me double check.
Oh my God, it smells so good.
Call your girlfriend. Oh, it's pungent. I think I put a lot of white pepper. Oh, it's close. The crust. Okay, right now, the crust is kind of blonde. I want it to be more brown. I like a brunette little bottom. You know what I mean? Oh my God, it looks so good. Hell yeah. Oh my gosh, guys, it's here, it's happening. Ready? We did it. Do you see that? Depending on how even your nonstick pan is in terms of cooking. Oh, let me show it to you like this. What I like to do is when I pick up the pot stickers, it's really good to flip up the bottom part so that you get the crust to have plenty of air so you're not steaming it. Barbara, are you hungry? I know, it's East Coast dinner time. I'm hungry too. Y'all, I'm gonna eat this. Oh, here we go, drum roll for the tasting. Drum roll for the tasting, y'all, here we go. Here we go. Drum roll for the tasting. It's very hot. I'm going to taste it though. I personally prefer a crust that's more like this. Do you see that? How perfectly brown that is? Oh, am I doing this right? Oh, here we go. You see that? Woo, it's hot. Woo! But it's perfectly cooked, steam fried. Oh, God.
That is very hot. Here we go.
Oh, I love this brown. This is the flavor right here. Okay, I'm going to taste it. You're going to watch me taste it. Oh, God. I have a feeling it might be a little salty, actually. Oh. Oh, it's juicy. That's the inside. See that? Show you up here. Ooh. Oh, it's juicy. Oh my God, that's good. That juice is good. This probably could have used a little more fat and oil, actually. But the filling is perfectly seasoned. The filling is perfectly seasoned. I could eat this without soy sauce or vinegar. You know what I mean? It's not too salty. It's perfect. I actually really like the ratios that we did. Look at that. I'm going to finish it. Mmm. Oh, good. Mmm. Y'all, I love potstickers so much. And it's like such a big part of my childhood and the childhood of so many immigrant kids. So I just want to thank you for watching. It's amazing that you stuck with me and got the full tutorial. I got to cook in real time for you. I'm going to pull together the highlights in Instagram and in a separate video, I think. So thank you so much. And here's what we made. We did this together. It's juicy and good. Perfectly seasoned. Taiwanese style potstickers. I'll see you on Instagram at Jenny Yang TV and hopefully back here YouTube streaming because I think I figured out the process. We'll see. Okay? Hope you have a good day. Let me just write some goodbyes here on the comments. Goodbye to, say some goodbyes. Goodbye to Barbara Gilbert, Jenny Kim, Brent W., Jennifer Kuo, Yvette with the drooly face. Thank you. Yeah, man. We did it. I'm about to eat another one. This is... Mm. Do you hear the... So juicy. I see how it's steaming. Oh yeah. Oh, it's hot. Sorry. I'm talking and chewing. Thank you so much. I'll see you on Instagram. Mm-hmm. 谢谢大家。